Like everything Myfordboy does, this was well packaged and arrived here in less than 2 weeks from the UK, even during the beginning of this holiday season. And while I am contractually forbidden from telling you who he really is or where he lives, I can tell you it appears he drinks Budweiser beer. The specific cans that are shown in Myfordboy's video are a British product and do not appear to be available here in the States. But if you look around, you will be able to find very similar sized cans. But you need to kind of feel the side of the can, and you want to make sure that they're smooth. Some of the cans that have that pull open top on them, they have corrugations down the sides. And even other cans have corrugations on the sides. You can't use those. You have to find a can that is smooth. You want to look for cans that have an inside dimension of this lip of 72.1 to 72.3 millimeter. And the outside is about 73.1 to 73.2 millimeter. Anything roughly that size should work. Inside the package, the parts have been carefully wrapped and placed in the package so that they would not be damaged in transit. And there's a package here that says, be careful and don't lose the small parts. And there's a piece of material for the diaphragm. I followed a little different sequence on the assembly of this engine. When I cut my cans out, I used a pair of green aviation snips, and I'm right-handed, and so this worked well for me. And those serrated jaws put just a little bit of a crinkled edge on here. And our cans, at least the cans that I got, are marginally larger than the can used in the UK. And I had to sand the inside of these rings on both of them, just almost removing that black burnt edge. And then this can would go on there. I used a flat file and just raked it across that edge to remove those serrations. And then I sanded the edge of the can with some fairly rough sandpaper to scratch it up, hopefully giving that epoxy a little bit of tooth on that can. I did the same thing on this one. Now this can butts up against that thermal break ring. You know straight away how that's going to go together. And I used the little blocks on here to make sure that the distance from here to here was per the design. I used Brie Wax water-based dye. I used this marking jig and this bending template as a test for that dye. Put it on all these pieces before I glued it on here, making sure not to get it onto the surface that was going to be epoxied. Then I sealed this with a mixture of linseed oil, wipe-on poly, and naphtha. And it gives it a nice, dull finish. And now you can rub your finger on that, and you're not going to pick up any color. I sanded the edge of this to rough it up before I put this on as well. And you just want to make sure, mine tried to hydraulic away from the edge of this can. It's kind of surprising, but you want to make sure, especially if the can fitting is tight as these do, that this ring is all the way down on that edge. I used 15-minute epoxy, gave me a little more working time, and the ends of this can appear to have a type of plastic coating on it. And I sanded that away and scratched that up real good, any place the epoxy was going to go, so that I would get a better bond with that metal can. And then, not so much to seal this to make it airtight, but to increase the surface area that it's adhered to, I came back and put just a little fillet of epoxy all the way around here. On this wheel, this is laser cut, both of these pieces, so the hole in there is tapered. So when you put those two pieces together, you're going to end up with two tapers like this, or a taper and a taper, or a taper and a taper, and it's kind of hard to tell which way a taper goes on a small part. So I used a numeric drill to line up the holes here. and just went ahead and glued that together. I didn't worry about it. My bearings would not stay in these two blocks. So I wiped the inside of that hole very sparingly with tight bond glue and stuck those bearings in there. I put that shaft in there to make sure they were correctly aligned. And after that glue set up, I came back and put a little fillet of that tight bond glue to hang on to that flange on that bearing. And that's in there quite good. And when I epoxied this in here, trying to get this to run true is a bit of a trick. I used just a little bit of epoxy in this hole and then stuck the shaft in there so it would push the epoxy out to this edge. I wanted to be real careful and not get any in this bearing. And I put a piece of tape right here on one of these webs, and I used that as a reference and watched that go back and forth using the edge of this support as a reference point until I can get that thing lined up. One of the problems with the epoxy, until that epoxy starts to set up, that shaft won't stay where you put it. And then as the epoxy sets up, it has a little bit of a memory to it. So you move the shaft in one direction and the epoxy says, no, I want you back over here. So if you get that lined up pretty good and you set this over to one side to dry, when you come back, excellent chance it's not going to be in alignment. So you have to play with that. And then pushing it in and out of this bearing is real easy to get things misaligned again. One other thing that I did, I used my cordless drill and I very gently tightened that up in there. So now I'm using the chuck as a pin vise. And with that piece of tape on there, as I turn that, I look to see how much that's moving. And I get the deflection over to this side. I can reach hold of this hub and just bend on it just a little bit. Now, if the epoxy hasn't set up yet, it will move. If you're doing this after the epoxy has set up, then you're trying to bend that brass shaft. And you got to be real careful if you start doing that. In the drill, it looks pretty close. When I put this on here, it's not too bad. Ron's going to call that good enough. When I put this hub on here, I made sure I used two different drills. I lined up the center hole, and I lined up this hole. When I assembled this, I did it after this one was in and the epoxy was cured, and I ran that pin in with the cordless drill. No glue. And I took a little super glue and let it wick in on this side and a little bit on that side, and I called that good enough. I screwed up the first diaphragm. I had this drum tight and it needs to be much looser. And I took a 5mm nitrile glove. I cut the finger off. I cut the end off of the finger, opened it up. And this is a fender washer. This is not quite an inch and a half in diameter. It just so happens it's about the same diameter as one of these tea candles. So I lay that on there, draw around it, cut it out as a circle. Then this thing is still a bit too tight. I had trouble getting the diaphragm adapter to stick to the nitrile with my super glue. So I put it on centered and I ran the crank pin to 6 o'clock.
to hold down on the diaphragm and waited a couple hours for the super glue to fully set. Now I will loosen the ring again because the diaphragm is still too tight. And I rotate the crank pin until it is at 12 o'clock and gently push down on this ring. The diaphragm movement must exactly match the up and down travel of the diaphragm crank pin. Don't get too carried away pushing down on this ring. It is just made of MDF, and you can break it. This is silicone fuel tubing for model airplane engines, glow fuel, and I don't remember what the official size is, but this outside diameter is 5/32, and it will push in that hole very firmly. And you can take this and you can suck and blow on it. I doubt if you can see that on camera. This is moving up and down very slightly. This can may be a little bit heavier than the one in the UK, plus I've added this fillet of epoxy around here, which limits its movement. And I can see the bottom of this going in and out. Very slightly, but it is. So I think I am airtight. The diaphragm is a silicone glove. About the time I think it's going to run, it does this and it quits. I think the wick on my candles is too short, at least for my engine. If I put it up on this lid, quite.